graveyard session. We were supposed to be before lunch, but we'll try and make it as interesting for you. The topic that we're going to discuss is really about how the AMC and distributor relationships should evolve, how AMC should think about value adding to the distributor, and how distributors can approach their relationship building with the asset managers. Before I start with a couple of thoughts on the topic, I want to introduce my fellow panelists. To my extreme left is Sunil Subramaniam. Sunil is the Director of Sales and Marketing of Sundaram. To my immediate left is Ajit Menon, Director of Sales and Marketing again of DSP BlackRock. Hemant Rastogi spent many years in the asset management industry, now runs one of the leading IFA practices, Wise Invest Advisors. And Misbah, who's been a key part of building probably what is one of India's most successful distribution practices in the last decade. I think what's really interesting about this panel, and I realized it when I looked at the profiles, is all the people on this panel have spent their career in both the asset management and the distribution world. And so I think it's good to get a perspective on both counts rather than having the AMC speaks for the AMCs and so on and so forth. Just to set the context of the discussion, I think one of the reasons why this topic becomes relevant is something that I've personally seen, particularly in the last 2 to 3 years, which is the whole approach to building a relationship between an AMC and a distributor, having a conversation between an AMC salesperson and a distributor RM, is completely driven by performance and commission. Often you find that almost half an hour conversations are only dedicated to performance and pricing, and there's no discussion around that, which goes on to aspects like training, helping to build the business, et cetera. And so what I think we'd like to do over the next 30 minutes, and then we leave 10 minutes for Q&A, is try and talk about our own individual thoughts about how AMC should think about building the distributor relationship, and then specific aspects of that as we go along. So Ajit, I'll start with you. You know, just your initial thoughts on how do you see the distributor AMC relationship? How is it built for you over the last decade? And particularly given that you work with so many different categories of distributors, do you think about this whole subject on a common basis for all of them, or do you think about it differently for each category?
Thanks, Anthony. I think, you know, to set the context for this, I think we've got to first realize that if this industry is about the investor, then the first connect and the last connect that the investor has is really with the advisor. And whatever happens, changes in the marketplace, performance of products, changes in regulation, the monkey is always on the advisor's shoulder to explain it to the client. And that's always a very, very, very difficult task. Let's also understand that over the last many years, technology has grown so much, the avenues of communication has grown so much, that there's so much more information available with investors themselves. And I think that is the context in which value add as a subject becomes important within the relationship of the asset manager or the manufacturer and the advisor. Now, we are all obsessed about our numbers, we obsess about our targets at all points of time. But the fact is, to give you an example, if there was a football team playing a match and there's a coach, it's like the coach focusing only on the scoreboard. It's more important to focus really on what is the play that the team is doing on the ground. And value add as a subject for manufacturers actually fall in that space where we help the advisor to try and build their business, which is what at DSP BlackRock we've been attempting for the longest time, since we don't have any other business but this mutual funds, which we feel we are a little extra passionate about. So in that context, I think the avenues that are available and what we have used as a manufacturer is clearly both offline as well as online. A lot of online for people that we may not be able to reach out to physically. And there's a lot of information that we provide on our distributor website, whether it's presentation, knowledge series, and we do offline events for advisors, most of them being in the soft skill arena, which help in sort of behavioral training more than anything else to adapt themselves to their client. So I think, therefore, the relationship between the AMC and the advisor is very important when it comes to the subject of value add, if you just keep performance and pricing out for a moment. And that's my view.
Misbah, over to you. I mean, you know, you obviously are a significant recipient of the value add, quote unquote, that AMC seek to deliver given the size of your business. And in many ways, you're also a manufacturer, right? Because you have this whole partner program, and in some ways, you are the AMC to those partners. So to your mind, how have you approached what is your view firstly on the kind of value add you think the AMC fraternity has delivered to you? And also, how do you think about value adds in terms of how you deal with your partners, and also how you think the industry should deal with you?
For any distributor manufacturer relationship, the first and the foremost very important for a distributor is this, that the manufacturer focuses on the products that it is manufacturing. So to our mind, the most important thing that we expect probably from a asset management company is the quality and the consistency of the product that they are probably manufacturing and what we are selling. So that is my, to any distributor probably it will be the most of the epitome importance. Having said that, as a distributor or as an advisor, we undertake a lot of activities because it is our job to see that the products that is manufacturer reaches to the customer. So to make that possible, probably we as a distributor or as an advisor undertake a lot of activities which are centric around probably creating the awareness, probably undertaking the activity for acquiring clients. Ajit said that training is more of a perpetual requirement for any distributor. So this is one specific area where probably if an asset management company engages a lot with the distributor, it can be a great win-win situation for us. We have been experiencing great support from the many of the asset management company, and that has only helped us to create the magnitude of the business, and probably it will be continuously needed. In addition to that, when we talk about this activity, in addition to that, it is also important that whatever activity has been done at the ground level, that they are reviewed. Because what my feeling is, or what my study says, that many of the activities are happening at the ground level, done by the asset management company, done by the distributor, but without any having specific mindset as to what is actually we want to achieve from that particular activity, they are not reviewed. So probably this is one other area which is very much highly required, that most of the activities which are done are reviewed. In addition to it, I would like to add one more point, which probably it's a point which everybody would appreciate. Today, the major challenge which as an advisor at the distributor fraternity we face is to create the awareness of the product of mutual funds. India is a population, but a highly illiterate in terms of finances. So the major job that we have to do currently is to create awareness. We all are doing, probably. Everybody are doing his own way. The asset managements are helping it also in that particular things. Everybody are doing to the maximum possible extent. Against that, what probably we receive sometimes is that bad news from a newspaper talking something negative about the mutual funds, and we again have to go back to the investor explaining again and again the same thing. So probably what probably is needed today is that a investor awareness campaign can be launched from a platform like AMFI, which is a platform which is there. And if such kind of an investor awareness program is launched by these people who have that scalability, because they have the access to the funds, they take fees from us in terms of enrolling fees. Probably as an AMC, probably you have now a leeway of 2 paisa to charge additional for customer awareness. So these are the areas where I feel that if something is done from the common platform, probably as an advisor or as a distributor, we probably have to spend less time and can increase the productivity, to a much larger extent. So that's my second point. The third point which I would like to highlight is, which again everybody would agree, that when we go and sell a product to an investor, the major time ultimately goes after selling the product to the investor is into managing the transactions and servicing the client. Right, there has to be means to be developed to see that this kind of time reduces, so that we could focus more on to sales, which we could focus more on to advice, which is probably the need of any distributor or any advisor. What we feel is that an exchange platform and dematerialization of units probably is an excellent way where the much time which is going to the operation, much time which is going to the servicing can reduce to minuscule. And more time can be given by us into advising and sales, which is probably our bread and butter. So my another expectation would be that to build a stronger relationship, to see that our business and your business develop, probably there is a very immediate need that we come together and project Exchange as a superb, viable, long-term platform for the investor to be associated with me. So these are, according to me, the three basic things which probably can help a distributor and an AMC build a very stronger relationship.
Hemant, over to you, and you're in an interesting position because you spent so much of your career adding value to distributors. You're a distributor today. Now that you're on the other side of the fence, so to speak, how do you look at the whole aspect of AMCs helping you build your business? I mean, your thoughts on it.
Well, you know, having been a part of the mutual fund industry for long and today running a distribution firm, let me first, you know, start with acknowledging the fact that the relationship between distributors and mutual fund has improved considerably. It's much more open than what it used to be. So I think we have come a long way. But I believe there are two, three areas where, you know, both need to work. One, because the challenges are same and opportunity are same. And also, I think the important factor is that both the entities need to realize one thing, that both have to grow. One cannot grow at the cost of other. So I think once we keep that in mind, the relationship will go to a different level. What are the areas that we need to focus on? One is when we talk about expanding the market. Okay, we haven't really seen much effort, even though what we see is on and off, there are, you know, seminars happening, there are, you know, workshops happening. What we need to develop today is, I think, something on a permanent basis. The point I'm trying to make is today the focus is to go beyond 15 cities, for example. We do a workshop for half an hour somewhere, and we go back after, let's say, 2 months or 3 months. It's very difficult for the distributor or small agents there to remember what they discuss. What I'm trying to say is that, especially in the cities beyond these 15 cities that we're talking about, have something in a permanent structure. For example, if the industry can set up a training institute or a training setup of which the distributors as well as the industry people can be the common faculty, the point is that allow these programs to happen throughout the year, maybe once in a week or once in a fortnight, where you can cover the basic as well as the advanced one, which means that if I attend one program and I've understood something and I want to come back again, give me a chance to come back again after a month or so. And also, if I feel that now I'm ready to learn more about, you know, advanced things, I should have an opportunity to do that. If we talk about these cities, I don't think collectively we are going to be spending obscene amount of money on that. I think it's very important that we start creating something which is permanent. The second aspect, I think, where the industry and, you know, distributor need to work together is on having better communication. Okay, I must admit that the level of communication, the quality of communication has improved considerably over the years. But I think there are still some areas where we need more openness. I'll give you a couple of examples here. You know, when the funds are launched, there are a lot of information which is available. There are funds which have been doing well, suddenly they don't do well. There's no communication. Okay, now it could be because the markets are not doing very well. It could be because the strategy that is being followed may not work for a certain period, but may work in the long run. In the absence of that, distributors who are not equipped to analyze it themselves, or I must admit that there is information available on one-to-one basis, but I think on a broader basis, in terms of, you know, letting everyone know, the communication doesn't happen. Now, what I'm trying to say here is that if it is explained as to why the particular fund or particular strategy is not working, it becomes easier for distributors to go and explain to their clients. The second is I would like to see is the kind of communication that happens, the quality has to be different for the people who understand and people who do not really understand. What I'm trying to say is if we use a lot of technical jargons in terms of what has happened in the market, maybe you know, the guys in Mumbai and the metros will understand that. But in the smaller towns, they may not be able to really absorb that and explain to the clients. While we keep focusing on getting new clients, expanding the market, I think we need to give equal importance to retaining the clients. So I think it's very, very important that we improve our communication on specific and also create something on a permanent basis where, you know, people can really enhance their skill. And one more area, whenever we talk about workshop trainings, is mainly on mutual funds, what mutual funds are, what markets are, not too much emphasis on soft skills. I think this is where everyone needs to realize that we are living in an environment where convincing, we need to change the mindset of people, which is a very, very difficult task. So you need different kind of skills altogether. It is not just knowing what a mutual fund is or markets are. You are changing the client's mindset, for which I think we need to focus on developing the marketing and the selling skills of all those who are involved in the distribution.
Sunil, you know, at Sundaram, I know you've created a very broad array of products and, you know, sold it through a wide category of distributors. And, you know, in that process, is there things you've done differently, because some of these products have been unusual, they've not been done before. And in your experience, has your work on value adding differently helped you? And really, you know, just on a broader context, how do you look at this whole subject?
Thanks. I think between Ajit, Hemant and Misbah, there's probably 60 years of combined experience, which has probably spoken about every aspect of this relationship. And so probably anything that I say will be of a repetitious nature. But I wanted to take a slightly different take before I come to the specific of the question. See, the topic that we talked about is mutual benefit between manufacturers and distributors. And typically, what is mutual benefit? That the win-win situation has to be created. Now, what is the win-win, right? Both of us need greater assets under management under our kitty. For the distributors to earn more upfront commissions, more trail commissions, for the manufacturers to earn more fees. So you look at it in a narrow perspective, mutual benefit is how do we increase the size of the assets as a combined entity that we manage. But I think what we are missing in this point, if you focus purely on this mutual benefit aspect, is the person who's giving us that mutual benefit. Right? That's the ultimate customer. Because if you look at the morning's presentations, which everybody did, and you know, I think the fund managers, when they spoke about, what they said was that the industry has failed in getting customers to invest when the time is right for them. Right? Now, what's the result of this? Now, whether we like it or not, right? I think the first thing we need to do is we need to think as one. That is, manufacturing also is, I don't think there's a mutual benefit. It's just one. It's one benefit, and that is the customer has to benefit. Unless the customer benefits, only then we benefit. So I think we should look at our relationship like a Siamese twins. We are inseparable. One can't exist without the other. So rather than look at it from, you know, you demand performance from me with good pricing, I give you good performance, so I want to bargain you down on the pricing, it's a more of a between brothers. But I think it's more to look at that we are a family. And what we have together is that customer whose wealth has to increase for us to then achieve our mutual benefit. So I think if we can turn this whole argument to how can we make the customer's assets under management, right? Whether it is rooted through X distributor or Y distributors, is irrelevant. For the industry as a whole, that asset under management has to increase. And for it to really increase, right, what is needed? There are three things, right? One is, you need to get more customers into the industry. Second is, you need to get a larger share of wallet of the customer. But the third and most important is, the money that you get from the customer has to grow. So there are three aspects to which, let's say 10 years from now, we want this industry to be 100 times its size. All of these three have to play a part. And unless we as Siamese twins approach this to say, hey, how can we expand the market in terms of new customers coming in? How can we then make sure the customers allocate a greater proportion? We all know that from our perspective, bank deposits are the one. 95% of customers' money across the country is in bank deposits. The insurance, mutual fund, all of us are fighting for the balance 5%. So our biggest effort should be to increase that 5 to 15. We are going to triple our industry. The third thing is, we have to make sure that these assets grow. Let us put it in the right asset classes at the right time, which is what the fund managers were talking about. So to me, if we look at, approach this whole thing of saying mutual benefit from this particular aspect, we'll get a whole new perspective on this. Because then you come down to doing the real things, which is, first of all, going and explaining to a customer who doesn't know anything about mutual funds about what it is all about. So what is the answer to that? We need to train our sales forces to go and talk to new people who say mutual fund And let's face it, somebody else spoke about emotions driving it rather than calculations, right? So it's about fear and greed, right? A customer is frightened of the equity markets from fear, but he sees the greed because somebody says, I married my daughter off just from my investment in Reliance's shares. So there's a greed plus fear emotional element, which every salesman, a distributor salesman and a mutual fund salesman in educating the distributor salesman needs to address in terms of why should one invest in the mutual fund industry, whether it's debt or it's equity, it's secondary. Second, in terms of, again, approaching the wallet penetration is, again, what? Essentially an inflation-related question, right? To a customer saying, you're putting most of your money into bank deposits, but inflation is clearly today, at any rate, better than the bank deposit, so you're getting a negative return. So the getting this message across, that's important. And third thing, in terms of wealth creation, it's all about timing. People showed us today that if you remain invested for 20 years, it's given a better return than gold. The Sensex itself. I'm sure fund managers have beaten that over that period of time. But this message to be communicated to the investor so that he puts his money at the right time. It is precisely when bad news is floating around, precisely when the PEs are down, precisely when everybody has a bad view, that's when he should put more money. But who is going to communicate this? Who is going to get over that fear? Because he's just coming from a position where over the last 5 years, he's lost all the money that he's put because he's not even got the bank deposit return from his investment. So I think if you look at this whole package, to me, ultimately it's all about training, education of the sales force, of the people, in how to go and approach this. Because in the absence of that, as an industry, I think we have to honestly admit that we have failed. With all the super performance from 2003 to 2007, how much of expansion of the markets have we achieved? How much have we really penetrated the wallet share? I would say hardly anything. And the reason for that is, again, because of this lack of training, we are in a, what would I say, purely sales mode, a product pushing mode. And I think what we need to adopt, and you know, if you look at the other industries which have succeeded, right, is a consultative selling. Understanding the customer needs, allocating his capital the right way, and doing that. For that, unfortunately, our sales force are people who are driven by this month's numbers, whether it's a bank RM there or it's anybody else. Everybody is worried about their roti kabda or makan. So the problem is that we have to make people understand that selling has to be consultative, has to be have the customer's interest in mind, and the only way out is education. And I think that's the way we see it. That's the only way forward from a...
Ajit, I just want to pick up on one of the points that Sunil made. You know, one of the reasons why we have sessions like this, which where we say we don't want to discuss performance and pricing, is perhaps because we don't do a good job of communicating performance itself, right? And do you think that as an industry, there is a need for us to think of talking about performance, communicating performance in a far more industry expansion way than currently this whole obsession with explaining to distributors whether your performance is Q2 or Q3 or Q1 and so on and so forth?
You know, Anthony, actually, I was talking to a couple of my colleagues in BlackRock. Now, obviously, international markets are far more matured. Even clients are far more matured. The penetration levels are different. But when I ask them what is it that matters typically to advisors, in the sense to take to customers, they said that there are 12 things that matter. And the first 10 are performance, 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 performance. And then the 11th is, how often do you connect with me as a manufacturer, and how often do you turn around my issues and resolve them for me? Now, that's obviously a far more matured market. The clientele is also matured, and it may be different when we are at our stage of evolution. Here, we all talk about it, that it's still being sold, not bought. So the challenges are very different. But to your point, I think that there is definitely merit in saying that while we all individually obsess about our product performances and distributors obsess about the products that they've already sold to clients and explaining the performance of that, the probably one step could be to ensure that we, as an industry together, as Sunil also mentioned, start communicating the performance of the category as a whole. I mean, there is enough data. The regulators talk about it, the fact that there are 70% of the equity funds that have beaten the benchmark across time periods. So if we were to talk about category returns, whether it is fixed income or equity, before we even boil down to product performance, that could probably be one step that we could adopt as a new way while we discuss performance with clients.
Go back to Misbah on the same point, right? Misbah, you are the recipient of every asset management salesperson waxing eloquent about performance. But in any of those discussions, do they really help you take your business forward? Or are the discussions always about me, myself, and not really about how the performance has been for the customer that you've brought to the asset manager?
Yeah, Anthony, as I said before, to us, performance is, as Ajit also said, so if I have to top down the list of what is actually required from a manufacturer, so performance is one of the toughest that come across, right? That it is the hardcore requirement for us that the performance is good, there is a consistency in performances, and the investor who have invested are happy investors, rather than we going to them and explaining the reasons as to why there is an underperformance. So it is an epitome requirement. But to me as a distributor, when you talk about the asset management company discussing a lot on the performances with us, yes, there are times when we do require the support or do require the explanation from the asset management company, especially when there are times when there are underperformances and the reasons which we need to communicate to the investors. So definitely there are times where we counteract with the asset management company, especially when there are underperformances. As far as performances are concerned, I agree to a very valid fact that it is our duty to communicate the performances to our customer. I will just give you a very simple example why it is important. Few days before, you know, I was visiting one of my branches and an investor came to me and saying that I'm completely unhappy with my performance. In what? I said, I've invested a lot and I'm invested into mutual funds since 2002. And if I see my current valuation report, it is only showing 2% of compounded annualized return. So where I am, where I'm investing, and what is the big benefit for me to invest into this mutual funds? Now, I will now tell you as to how we showed him the report. You know, the current valuation report only talks about his investments, probably which he has done 6 months before, a year before, or a 3 months before, right? He would have put in some money 3 months before. He would have redeemed some money and reinvested or reinvested into some other scheme. So the current valuation report don't show anything. So we actually, what we did was we breaked up his investment from 2002 to 2012. And actually what return he actually got was something like that he invested 19 lakhs of rupees and what he has made earning from mutual fund was 25 lakhs of rupees. So out of 44 lakhs which he has invested, or the current valuation which was showing 44 lakhs, the net gain to him as an investor into mutual fund was nearly 25 lakhs with a CAGR of around 11%. And when we showed to him that this is what your performance is, you being an investor from 2002 till 2012, then he could really understand exactly what is the kind of return I've got from my investments. So according to me, it is very, very important, right, that the performances with the funds he has invested is properly communicated to the investor. Unless and until it is not done in a proper manner, probably it will just result into misconceptions, which is probably we are seeing today. People just say that I have not got any returns. That's what most of the newspaper, which I was even telling in my first part, you know, that if you go into through the media, probably an investor can read across that I have not made any money from my investment. And the fact, when we go back and make his detailed study, and probably we come to know that the investor actually has made a decent return from his investment. So I really believe that it is very important. And rather than an AMC teaching us as a distributor that these are my returns, those data are very much available everywhere. It is our duty as an advisor that we communicate those things to the investor rather than expecting too much from the asset management company onto that. Our expectation from AMC is to deliver.
I'm just going to change the tone of the discussion a little bit, just to look beyond the industry, right? So Sunil, you talked a little bit about that in your opening remarks. So you just share with us your thoughts, perspectives, and I know you worked across the financial services industry. Are
aspects or things from other industries in terms of managing channels that we can think about in terms of the way we look at this whole thing, particularly because they have obviously scaled up in terms of customer penetration, etc., all of that stuff you spoke about far more than us. So are there things that they do differently when they think about their intermediary clients?
What comes to mind from this perspective is the pharmaceutical industry. Okay, I would say, you know, AMCs are the Pfizers and the Glaxos of the world, but the distributors and the advisors are actually the doctors of the world, who are providing a service to their investor where he's taking decisions on his behalf, which the investor doesn't have the complicated knowledge of the markets or of what is going to happen. When a patient comes to a doctor, he believes he's going to get well. So he issues the prescription, he buys it, right? So it's similar to that. If you look at the relationship between an investor and the IFA or the distributor as a patient-doctor relationship, right? The IFA is then, the key element is trust, right? So I think that is the key element, that as an industry, the investor is trusting us, right? The manufacturer is manufacturing the product and the doctor is delivering that product to that customer. So the proof of the pudding is known much years later, 1 year later, maybe 2 days later if it's stomach pain, a year later if it's a heart attack, right? So I think the key, if you look at that industry, how it manages, I think the relationship building between the salesman of the pharma company and the doctor in providing him the tools necessary to do his job well, I think it's been a phenomenal success if you look at the pharma industry and the way it's operated. And I think if distributors can get into the mindset of thinking of themselves as the doctors to their investor patient, the difference being that a patient goes to a doctor when he is suffering, but an investor is coming to this doctor as a man with hope. So the fundamental difference is that he doesn't have a pain right now, but he has a hope of building a better future for himself, wealth creation. So it's a wonderful opportunity which he's coming to. And if we, together between the manufacturer and the advisor, can deal with him in a very similar way, right, in terms of making his task easier, to developing and enhancing that trust and delivering that value, I think that could be a way forward.
Again, switching gears a little bit because we have limited time, so I want to try and touch as many topics as possible. Value add sometimes automatically to most of us in this room, I think, is a frontline subject. But there is a lot of room for value add on the back end, right? And I think particularly with the IFA practice you run, I know I have a lot of IFAs coming to me and saying, you probably will add far more value if you help me deal with my end customer issues and processes than if you explain to me how great your next fund was. And so, you know, you obviously live this every day. Do you think there's actually as big a role for value adding from AMCs to you at the back end as much as it is in the front end?
Absolutely. I think it is very much there. Because as I mentioned earlier, I think the focus also has to be on retaining the clients. While we all talked about the importance of performance in the whole game plan, which nobody can deny, but the fact is that there are times, for example, if there are times where 2 or 3 years the markets have not done any well, everyone understands the markets have not done well, so I think that's where you need to put performance into perspective. That if markets have not done well, you've not got the performance, I think many times investors are okay with that. The back end, why it becomes important is, you know, we project mutual fund as a very simple vehicle of investment. But the fact remains that there are a lot many complications at the back end. I think this is one area where the industry and the distributors need to work together and find out solutions for that. I'll give you one example. Like, there are so many processes, procedures, which are different for different registrars, different for different mutual funds. There are times when investors say, I mean, did I make a mistake of investing in a mutual fund? Because it's being projected as an investment option, which is very, very simple. But the fact is, I think we need to sit together and find out solutions for this. We also talked about, you know, problem in conveying the performance. And I'll give you a reason for that. Most of the distributor, whether they're small or big, they can't really afford very fancy softwares. Okay? The problem is the software which are available in the market, which are available for 5,000 or 10,000, they only give you the current performance, as you mentioned rightly. Now, the client who has been with you for last 7, 8, 10 years, he sees only what has happened to my portfolio now for the current investment. None of these softwares have a provision to give you the full statement of what has happened to his entire investment. So I think apart from the fact that what is the interaction that is happening with the registrar or the mutual funds, I think this is also another area, because at the end of the day, what is important is that customer, the client, should get, you know, update on his investment at all times and the correct information. And also something which he can analyze himself, whether he's actually made money or not. So I think we need to streamline processes. We need to make it simpler. As I said, you know, the procedures have to be same. I'll give another example. Many a time when the registrars are changed, it's a nightmare. You know, there is a time when for a period of 15 days or 1 month, neither you get information from the earlier registrar nor from the new registrar. So for almost for a period of 15 days to 1 month, you're completely blank on what is happening. You are used to sending portfolios to the clients on a regular basis. Suddenly the data feed stops coming. So for months together, that information doesn't go. So I think it's very, very important to streamline all these processes where the customer should not have any problem. Or even if the changes have to be made, it should be very smooth so that, you know, at no point of time, customer should feel that he made a mistake of investing in mutual funds.
Thank you. I'd like to now take the opportunity to stop asking questions myself and actually give the audience a chance to ask questions. So we could probably take two or three questions because we have about 5-7 minutes to go. So if you have a question, raise your hand and I think somebody will come with a mic to you. Yeah, just wait for the mic. If you could just introduce yourself and...
I'm Nilesh Kapadia from Aurangabad. Just two very quick questions. We're talking about simplification all the time, simplification for the investor. Why can we not print the returns of that scheme for the investor, just like you print the NAVs for each scheme? I think that's a very simple technical process. And it's just a suggestion that for every account statement that gets printed, why can't the returns from that scheme for that investor be printed? It's simple. It saves the time for the advisor. It makes it easier for the investor to understand. And along with the NAV, he knows what is the returns from that scheme. I think it's a very simple this thing. To also feel that the AMC and the advisor, they are like mother and father. And the investor is like the child. And somewhere along the line, the faith between the mother and the father has kind of dwindled. And the child is feeling lost. Who should he go to? And more than anything, I think that needs to be strengthened so that the investor as a child gains more confidence. I leave it to the expert panel to...
So Ajit, do you want to take the... I think the first question is just feedback. I think we'll take back to the RTAs and to respective AMCs. On the second question, Ajit, I think his point is there a sense of, you know, he talked about a mother-father relationship, it's a marriage. Are we also seeing a sense of a period of separation? And so is there, you know, and it's not divorce, obviously, because like Sunil said, it's impossible to be divorced. But over the last 2-3 years, and particularly given the recent regulatory changes, the discussion around direct, et cetera, is there a feeling of separation that is coming through, and do you think the AMCs need to do something about that?
Actually, you know, Sunil mentioned about Siamese twins. Now we are talking about the 7-year itch, probably. But not to my mind. I think, I know. So I would rather, you know, actually agree with what Hemant had mentioned earlier, that to my mind, having been in the same space for more than 13 years now, I've seen the relationship actually improve dramatically. But specifically to that point, I think, you know, in the earlier stages, I think the relationship was just transactional. Any senior person would go out for a 5 lakh or a 25 lakh ticket when it was 97 or 98, 99 that I hear about. As Sunil mentioned later, it's moved to being consultative. Is there a stage that it goes to beyond this? Well, internationally, I do hear from my peers that it does go to one more stage, which is specialization, where you would have advisors finally specializing into areas like retirement or children's education or estate planning and, you know, and doing far more advisory within what they give clients, which then requires the manufacturers to start educating their own internal teams or setting up internal teams that can service that particular segment. So the first question that you had asked, clearly it's different strokes for different folks. There are advisors and there are transaction-oriented distributors. Smaller markets have lesser knowledge and experience. Larger markets have far more of it. And it's a constant challenge for both, I'm sure, at the AMC level, and I'm sure for also the distribution network to ensure that we are giving, communicating the same message to the end client.
Sunil, you had a question.
Sunil, I must congratulate you because you're the first person who actually spoke about investors first right now in this forum, where, and I was the first one to actually clap. I believe in the same philosophy. If investors will make money, all of us will make money. So it's not you and me, it's all of us. So having said that, the other aspect which I wanted to discuss with Anthony and your panel was the lack of awareness of the product and the strategies behind those products by the sales team. So when they come to us, they say, sir, fund manager likes this short-term plan because it has generated 12% return, 13% return over the last 1 month, 3 months, etc. That's not what we are looking from the sales team of the AMCs. We want sales team to be replicating the fund manager's views. So they need to be coming prepared, saying, why are you recommending? Is the story behind us? Is it going to take it forward? And if it's going to take, if the story is going to continue, then what are the reasons why it's going to continue? So this is what is lacking as far as I believe in the, not, I'm not saying generally, most of the times.
I think what you're saying as feedback for AMCs in terms of distributors is, when you think about the fact that training is a value add to distributors, think about the fact that training your sales team is a value add to the distributors as well. And I think particularly in the area of fixed income versus equity, right? Because everybody is a specialist at equity and a mini portfolio manager, but fixed income is a whole new game.
So has the access to speak to the fund manager or the CIO, etc. So the CIO's language, whether equity or debt, should be replicated by the sales team, and that's the same message should go to the advisors, which will in turn pass on to the investors.
We have time for one more question. I think, Vinayak, you have one.
Good afternoon. My name is Vinayak Sapre. It's not a question, actually. It's a suggestion to the sales team. Though I have been on the manufacturing side for good 12 years, what I have seen that most of the sales manager try to become investor manager, investment manager, especially on the retail side. I'm not talking about the Sunil segment, Mr. Javeri's segment, but I'm talking about the at the retail level, wherein people who are interacting with the IFAs, typically a sales guy who visited, I mean, I'm talking about the people who have worked with me as well. If the IFA says, market achha nahi hai, the guy comes back. If you, what we've seen in the morning presentations, market achha nahi hai, it means probably it's the best time to invest. The sales guy should be able to tell this, the distributor, how it can be helpful if you have the investment today. If you have the guts to go to the client today and get the investment, you will have a happy investor 2 or 3 years down the line. But typically people try to become, and I have seen the sales guys who have struggled, who tried to become investment manager rather than a sales manager. I think they should stick to their job, which is a sales manager's job.
Sure. Okay. I think we've run out of time, and I hope even though this was the graveyard session, it was useful for all of you. And we are around and happy to have a discussion. Thank you for a very, very patient hearing. Thank you.